Hi, folks. Thanks for joining. We are going to talk about multi-data center clusters. My name is Alexander. I live in France, and I'm a consultant for a small company called The Last Pickle. You might have seen a few of my colleagues, actually, in this summit. And I'm a DataStax MVP for Apache Cassandra. Here is what we do. We help you deliver and improve your Apache Cassandra-based solutions. And we are operating in 5 countries. This is the current state of the company. Pretty boring picture, if I may say. But after a few drinks, we ended up with a better one. Well, slightly. Sorry for that joke. So let's assume everyone knows that DC stands for data center. Why would you go multi-DC on your clusters? A few classic use cases: load balancing and disaster recovery. You would want to set up other DCs just to load balance your apps on them and use them as backups in case of problems, in case of downtime in one of them. Another classical use case is geographical collocation with clients. This is actually, I don't know if everyone sees it, the ping times to the different regions of Amazon when I'm from France. So obviously, I would want to connect to one of the regions closest to me, which would be Ireland and Frankfurt. So to achieve this, you would want to create different DCs for your cluster that will operate on specific parts of the world. Another use case would be to separate operational and analytical workload. If you're familiar to Spark, you know that querying Cassandra with Spark will mostly read all of the data of your tables. So that's very I/O intensive and CPU intensive, and you get unpredictable latencies, which is no fit for operational applications who need to meet low latency SLAs. So let's talk about consistency. Consistency in multi-DC clusters. We can separate two families of clusters: strongly consistent clusters, which have the following characteristics. Low latency between DCs. You must have at least 3 DCs in your cluster, and no search or analytical DCs, which, as I said, have unpredictable latencies. And you have eventually consistent clusters, which have the following characteristics: high latency between DCs, when you have exactly 2 DCs in your cluster, or when you have at least 1 search or analytical DC. We'll get back to that later. To create a key space for a single DC cluster, you will run the following statement, like simple create key space. If you have a single DC, you are mostly using simple strategy with a replication factor that usually is 3, let's say, but we'll take 7 here for the example. If you run this statement on a multi-DC cluster, you will end up with probably unbalanced replicas because it does not account for the DC. On multi-DC cluster, we will use network topology strategy, which allows us to specify the number of replicas per DC. And you can set different number of replicas on the DCs of the same cluster. That's up to you. And you can have a different number of nodes too in separate DCs of the same cluster. So if we run this query, this statement on this cluster, we will get a balanced set of replica on each DC. So to configure the DC on your nodes, considering you're not on AWS where you will use a specific snitch, which is EC2 snitch, you will most likely use a gossiping property file snitch, which allows you to specify on each node the DC it belongs to, in this Cassandra-RackDC.PropertiesFile. The consistency levels. We have a few non-DC aware consistency levels, which are 1, 2, 3, quorum, and all. I won't talk about any because you shouldn't be using any. And we have DC aware consistency levels, which are local 1, which is the default, like 1 was the default consistency level of non-DC aware. And we have a local quorum and each quorum. So each quorum will give you strong consistency as it will wait for a quorum of acknowledgement on each DC. A local consistency level will operate on a single DC only. We'll see that after in the read and write path. So, here's a quorum write on DC1. The client will connect to a coordinator node in DC1, expect a majority of answer, like a quorum of answer, on overall the cluster. So if DC1 cannot provide enough answers, it will go to replicas on DC2. The interesting thing is here that we have only one arrow between DCs, so that's an optimization of the communications between DC. Even if we have three replicas in DC2, only one set of value will be sent, and then the coordinator is responsible for spreading on the replicas of its local DC. A local quorum write on DC1 can succeed even if the remote DC does not answer in time or at all. So hints will be kept, we'll see that afterwards. But you see the dashed arrow means we do not need that node to acknowledge the write to answer, to have a succeeding query. Quorum read on DC2, pretty much the same as the write we had before, but the coordinator can reach directly the nodes of the other of the remote DC. So here again, we are expecting a majority of replicas to answer throughout the cluster. A local quorum read on DC1 will strictly run on DC1. So it will expect a quorum of replicas to answer on the local DC. And then the same on DC2. We expect quorum of replica on the local DC as well, sorry. So a bit of operations. We have a few specific configuration that can be set on the cassandra.yaml file for multi-DC clusters. You can throttle inter-DC streaming throughput. That can be very interesting if you have limited bandwidth between your data centers and if you want to avoid having streaming issues during repair or bootstrapping. By default, it is set at 200 megabit per second. You can turn on internode encryption for cross DC communications only, which is if you there is an overhead at encrypting and decrypting data. So if your intra DC communication is secure, you might not need encryption for it. But inter DC might follow link that are not secured, so you might want to activate encryption there using this configuration. The same goes for compression. Compression will save you bandwidth, but as an overhead in CPU usage. So for the same bandwidth issues, you might want to save a bit on inter-DC communications. And you can reduce TCP overhead by, it's eventually consistent DCs, by activating the inter-DC TCP node delay to true. This will send larger TCP packets, but fewer of them. So let's see how to add a new DC to an existing cluster. First, you'll want to migrate all your simple strategy key spaces to network topology strategy. We've seen that simple strategy is not suited for multi-DC clusters. You'll do this by altering key space. This can be done at the time of your choice. So you just alter your existing key space by setting in the network topology strategy. And for now, we are only going to put replicas on DC1. We will bring up DC2 later. So you might want, this is advised in the procedure, to disable auto bootstrap on new nodes. Actually, it's more of a security. It's not mandatory if all your key spaces are already using network topology strategy and have replicas on the existing DC2. But let's say that for safety, you will want to add this line in your cassandra.yaml file, auto bootstrap false. Then you can start your new nodes in this fresh new DC. At this point, the nodes are empty because we've disabled bootstrap and because we didn't set replicas on this DC. And they are not involved in reads nor writes. Now we can change the strategy parameters to add replicas on the new DC. So before moving on, you want to make sure your traffic is restricted to DC1 or you are using quorum. Otherwise, your apps will start communicating using DC2 to get answer and they are still empty. So we are gonna alter the key space once again to create the replicas on the new DC. And as I said, now the new DC accepts writes and reads, but they are still empty. Routing traffic to a specific DC is a dev task, okay? You have to pick a coordinator node in a specific DC. This is done by using the DC-aware run-robin policy in your, whatever your language is, DataStax driver, which allows you to do something that looks like this. You create your cluster object, setting the policy, and giving it the local DC. So your app will only connect to a node in this specific DC. That's just the first part. Then you have to tell the coordinator node to work only in the local DC, and then you'll have to use a local consistency level. Consistency level can be modified on the fly because that's something you can set per query. So you can use feature flips. I don't know if you're familiar with feature flips. It's features you can activate while your app is up. It's a classic continuous delivery technique. A load balancing policy cannot because it is set when you create your cluster object. So that's done when you start your app. So now we are ready to fill our new nodes with data taken from DC1. So you will run a rolling node tool rebuild with the name of the DC that actually has data on all nodes in DC2. This is a per node operation. So you don't want to overload your cluster by running it on all nodes at the same time, but you have to do it on all of your nodes. Now your new DC is ready, to rock, to run, whatever. Now that we've had it, added it, we are going to remove it. So how to remove DC2? So now you will have to switch traffic to DC1. You may want to run repair because you might have some data on DC2 that is not on DC1 because we are in an eventually consistent system. Hopefully you've seen my talk about repair yesterday. That will save you a bit of trouble, maybe. Then we are going to run an alter key space statement to where we remove replicas on DC2. And then we are going to decommission all nodes from DC2. So to do this, you just run node tool decommission on each node in the new DC, and they'll get removed from the cluster. So how does repair works in multiple DCs? When you run repair on a node in DC1, Merkle trees will get exchanged and requested from all replicas in all DCs by default. So you have a specific switch to repair only data inside your local cluster. So if you had disk failure on a specific node in a DC, you might want to repair it only in this DC to avoid the extra cost of repairing the distant DC. But cyclic maintenance repair has to include all of your DCs. So this is just for a specific use case. Should you run repair on all DCs? It's a bit hard to find proper information on this. Some might say, yes, you have to. I think you have to if you have simple strategy key spaces, because some replicas might exist only in one DC and not the other. If you are using the dash local switch, obviously, you have to run it on all nodes in all DCs. And the last case is if you have a key space that is not replicated to all DCs. You've seen that with NTS, we can create replicas on one DC and maybe not the other, and you may have more than two DCs. So these are the cases where you have to run repair on each node in each DC. Otherwise, you don't have to. You will probably want to avoid over-repairing your cluster. This is expensive, and each token range needs a single pass throughout the cluster. Between DCs, hints work mostly like they do between nodes in a single DC. We've seen the quorum writes or local quorum writes, most likely local quorum. If the remote DC is not there to answer the query, then the node that sent the request will keep a hint, just like it does for a node in its own DC. Hints can be disabled on specific DCs in the cassandra.yaml file. So this is what you'd want to configure. Let me rephrase this. So to disable hinted handoff in both DCs, you'll add these lines in the config file. So use this wisely, because hints is a pretty important technique to avoid entropy in your cluster and allow short downtimes for your nodes. Right? The hint window is 3 hours. If everything goes as expected, if a node goes down for less than 3 hours, then hints will take him back, sending back the data he missed during downtime. An advice for hints in multi-DC cluster, raise this value, the max hints delivery threads, to 4. Now we have some time to talk about failover. Failover in single DC clusters is pretty straightforward. If you are using CL1 or CL quorum, then you can lose, let's say, one or two nodes at a replication factor of 3, and you don't have to think about failover. It is natural. In a strongly consistent multi-DC cluster, it's the same. You are using non-DC aware consistency levels, so quorum can be achieved if you have enough replicas across the cluster. So once again, you have nothing special to do to have failover here. So you see we have here a strongly consistent DC cluster. Quorum can be achieved with our 3 data centers. And if we lose DC2, we can still achieve quorum. We are considering that each DC has the same number of replicas. So we can still have a quorum of replicas with DC1 and DC3. But in an eventually consistent cluster, what if my local DC loses quorum? How to handle failover in this type of case? Because if we can achieve local quorum read this way, I don't think that's the right. You'll see. Okay, that's actually a wrong schema. Shouldn't be there. But still, if we are losing, I'm totally messed up. I did this morning, I'm sorry. Let's just skip, I'll explain this to you. The thing is, in this case, you are communicating with a single DC, okay? You are using a local consistency level, which means if your local DC cannot achieve quorum, then you'll have failed queries all the time. And you have no automatic switch to the other DC. So that's something you have to build. And to build that, you have first to detect failure. That would be by using metrics to see if you reach a certain level of failed queries, or you can monitor token ranges, which would make you see that some token ranges cannot achieve quorum anymore. Then you have to switch traffic to the other DC. That can be at the network level, like you can route your queries, your web queries on other web servers in the other DC, or at the app level, where you will have different connections and switch between them as needed. Or you can do this at the driver level by creating a load balancing policy. You must prevent premature backswitch, because in case DC2 experience a downtime that is out of the hint window, like more than 3 hours, you will need to repair that DC. So you do not want to backswitch to it, otherwise you'll get inconsistencies. You can, as I said, build your own load balancing policy, mostly on top of the DC aware round robin policy. I did one. You can find it on my GitHub account. And one last thing is that if you have an analytical DC and still want not synchronous but strongly consistent operational DCs, you can use racks. Okay, so that would be instead of creating 4 DCs, you create 2 DCs with one with at least 3 racks. To create as many racks as your replication factor, obviously. And I think that's it. We have a few minutes now for Q&A, 10 minutes. Do we have a mic?
Yep.
And by the way, I have a few business card stickers if you want to grab some before leaving the room.
My question is, if you're going to do a migration, right, would you use the same thing where you want to migrate from one data center to the other? Would I do it just like you laid out and just decommission the other data center to do a move?
That's one of the techniques that is used. Actually, I don't know if everyone heard the question. To do a migration to another DC, then you bring up a new DC, you switch traffic when it's ready to this new DC, and then you can decommission your old DC. So yeah, that's actually a classic technique for this.
If I fail on a quorum on a read,
is that going to trigger read repair, so I just need to wait for a couple of seconds and then try it again on the same DC?
If the read fails?
I can't get quorum on my local cluster.
Yeah.
Will that trigger a read repair?
No. Read repair will help you solve write problems. Let's consider a write has been acknowledged only by one replica or two. Then when you come to read that data, if the Cassandra in the background, read repair is a subject by itself, but Cassandra in the background will try 10% of the time to see if other replicas have the same data. And if not, it will repair that specific row in the background. So the next time you'll come to read it, it will be the same on all nodes. But if a quorum read fails, then it fails. If you retry that read, it will only succeed if you have enough replicas to reach your consistency level.
Thanks. One thing we observe when decommissioning data centers, we see a message like removing token range for the decommissioned node, right? And that message keeps appearing for weeks and weeks after all the nodes are decommissioned. Did you have any experience like that? And
That might be gossiping issues. Maybe the sometimes you have the gossip doesn't propagate properly. So I think what's done in this case is you do a rolling restart of your cluster. You have to restart nodes and they will just get back in sync. It's quite the same as when you have schema conflicts. If you try to update the schema on the same key space but on different nodes at the same time, then you get conflicts. And at this precise moment, the only way to get it back to a same state is to roll restart the whole cluster. So yeah, sometimes gossiping is kind of a problem, especially on big clusters.
There was actually a very specific bug that was just fixed, I think, in 2.1.14 on that. I actually ran into that in production. So.
Okay, thanks. Oh, question here? Yeah.
Hey, so you basically don't need backups anymore, right? As you are like running a multi data centers cluster, so you can rebuild anytime from like another data center.
Yeah, that's a toughie. Backups in Cassandra is, I won't name the companies, but some pretty famous companies told us at some point, we have backups, we just hope we'll never have to restore them. So backups in Cassandra are useful to prevent from mostly human failure. So that would be someone coming and deleting or corrupting data, which can be done only on specific partitions. So you cannot run a delete on a full table. If you run a truncate, by default, it will make snapshots of your data, so you can still recover it. So by having multiple DCs, you can stay away mostly from backup problems, but that's really a full subject for a talk, I think. There's no easy answer to that. In my previous job, I wasn't making backups, actually.
So my question is about the failover scenario.
Sorry.
My question is about the failover scenario, is that, let's say, so we have two DCs, and we write to one of them, other one is just kind of more for like, in a sense.
I don't hear you, sorry.
So we have two DCs, write to one of, our clients mostly read-write from one, the other is more like we are replicating there and we run some Spark jobs, but let's say in a scenario if my main DC goes down, what should be, means like what should be our strategy so that clients can automatically fail over to the next one?
No, not to an analytical DC. You wouldn't be able to meet your SLAs.
Okay.
I think you...
So we should build a third one, which is...
I'm
thinking of a scenario where if this is DC, which is the main DC, where the traffic comes, if it has some problem, then how can I... What should be the strategy so that clients can
You need one more DC. Actually, I think if your analytical DC is pretty busy, which it should be, it won't meet your SLA, your latencies for operational needs. So bring up another DC at least, yeah.
You mentioned when you're in local quorum, your SQL cannot, your SQL, will die. So, and you have to do some changes. I remember reading some new functionalities that you can set up some step up consistency.
That you can use
with local quorum and you read with more quorum. So is it one of the options?
I mentioned the load balancing policies, but you have retry policies. So. The Java driver team implemented the downgrading consistency retry policy. If a query fails at quorum or at local quorum, it will retry it at one, not at local one. That's important. It will retry at one. So it can be eating your other DC, and then you won't be segregated to your local DC. So. That can be a way to have a better failover, but that can bring you some inconsistencies. And especially, it will prevent you from separating DCs one from the other. So you can use this, but wisely, know what you're doing. Here.
A small question. What happens if I use network topology strategy on a single DC cluster?
That works, actually. You can set, as I've done before creating DC2, you can just set NTS with a specific number of replicas on your DC. Your DCs have a name, whether you have one or many. By default, it's DC1. So yeah, you can do that, sure. And this is what you want to do if you have racks, especially. So even if you have a single DC, do not use simple strategy with racks. It doesn't care about racks. So you won't have that insurance that your replicas will be on different racks to allow you to have better failover possibilities. So as a rule of thumb, try to avoid simple strategy as much as you can.
So I'm using AWS with three availability zones with one DC. Do I need to do multiple, do I need three DCs to do this failover stuff, or will three racks do?
I think AWS regions have high latencies, so you are in...
AZs, not the regions.
Oh, AZs. So if you are using the EC2 snitch, I think it will use AZs as racks. So you have a single DC, and each AZ will be a different rack. So that should be a no-brainer for you. You don't have anything specific to do. Multi-region is different. It's good? Thank you.